Hello, and welcome to Prairie Pulse. Coming up a little bit later in the show, we'll explore the art of Annie Stein. But first, joining me now is the co-owner of Steep Me a Cup of Tea, with locations in Bismarck and West Fargo, Terisina Hintz.
Good job, you got it.
Thank you. As we get started, tell the folks a little bit about yourself, your background, where you're from.
Sure. My husband and I own Steep Me a Cup of Tea in Bismarck and in West Fargo. My husband and I have been working together since 2003, and a lot of people do ask, how do a husband and wife get along so well together to work? It has been a process and a struggle, but we do love it. We love being entrepreneurs, we like being self-employed, and we do like working together. In 2008, we opened our first Steep Me here in Bismarck. We really just wanted the concept of a place where you could come and get spices. That's where the whole idea had come from. My husband's a huge cook. He likes to do different spices and make different types of meals. And we thought it would be really cool to come in and buy spices that maybe would be country specific. And then you could certainly make a dish that would be of that origin. In order to do that, you could get recipes and the spices that would go with it. And so after researching some of the spices, we found that a lot of blends actually have tea in them. They do some black teas or they'll do some green teas to enhance the taste. And we thought maybe tea is a better way to go. When we started the idea in 2006, it took 2 years to research, but there was no tea places in North Dakota.
Yeah.
And so it was really cool to know maybe this is the way to go. So in Bismarck was our first location because we were raising our kids here. They were still in high school and there were 19 coffee shops. And we thought maybe a tea place would fit. A lot of coffee shops offer tea. You know, it's not their primary objective, but there is an option. We thought we wanted to be tea only. So you can come in, purchase a drink, buy the leaves. We'll teach you to make it at home and kind of expand on that. So.
Yeah, but you said you've been working together since 2003.
Yeah.
Before we came on the air, I think you meant this is not your first business. So,
no.
So are y'all from this area?
My husband is from Carson, North Dakota, a small town southwest, and I'm from Hebron, which is actually a small town west of here. We actually met in Dickinson, where I was finishing college, and he was raising his three boys here in Bismarck. And so we kind of I had an instant family. We started being together, and then my husband actually started his first business in 1996.
Okay.
He was a courier, and so we did just-in-time inventory all over the United States. And so we did that actually until 2012. And so we did that for a number of years. So yes, we did practice working together at that point. We did some home inspections for 6 years and then we moved into the tea business. So this business is really nice because we get to help people every day, but we get to close the doors at six. A lot of times when you have a business that's run by your phone, you're working 24 hours a day.
Sure. So you've told us about the stores. You've told us a little bit about what you specialize in. How did you come up with the name?
Steep Me a Cup of Tea came to my husband while he was riding his Harley Christmas Eve, making a delivery for the other business. We wanted something unique, but it also meant what it meant, because you steep tea and then you brew coffee. And so that's kind of the concept we went to. We also wanted to make sure we would be able to do a website with it. You know, you wanted to be able to brand those names together, and we just came up with Steep Me a Cup of Tea. So you know exactly what it is, what our store does. Yeah.
So how is business going? And how do you position yourself? You mentioned the coffee shops in sort of a coffee culture obsessed
world. Totally. Yeah, we're meat, potatoes, and coffee out here.
Yeah.
We didn't want it just to be a beverage place. We want it to be a place for wellness. So not only is tea taste good, it's good for a purpose. And so we really kind of expanded on the fact that if you have a really bad tummy ache, there's a tea that works really well for that. If you have a headache, or maybe you just have the common cold and you just don't want to do the medicine route at first, you wanted to try something all natural, that is where our focus has started. And really, that focus has kept us in business as long as it has. You know, having just teas and trying to make the normal bills that you would have as a business, you know, your construction loans, your regular bills to pay your employees, sometimes just drinks doesn't cover that. You really needed to focus on the customer service and the wellness side of it. And that's what we've done.
Okay. Well, with that said, let's back up a minute. Mm-hmm. How and where do you get your varieties of tea, and how many varieties are there out there?
Well, tea is a Camellia sinensis plant. It only makes 5 types of tea. So one tea or one plant is grown in the ground, and the way it's processed gives you different teas. So you get white tea, which is always the springtime of the year because it has the teeny tiny little bud that goes with it. After that, they pluck leaves all the months of the year, and then you get green, and then you go to oolong, and then black, and then a puer, which is a tea you don't find very often, but it's really good for you as well. So this one plant makes those five varieties, and then they all have their separate types of health benefits. So we recommend those different types of teas depending on taste and then exactly what you're looking for. You also do things or herbs that are made like a tea, but they're not actually the tea plant. So those are herbal teas. There's actually a specific tea from Africa called rooibos. That's another type of tea that's caffeine-free. And then you do yerba mate. And that's actually a roasted tea from South America. And that's what this little darker-looking drink is. So it's a great option, lots of variety. And for people, sometimes the hardest thing is really just choosing. You know, how do you pick? You know, what should I do? So.
Well, then I understand, though, that you and your husband are creating blends.
Absolutely. Yep. So we're focusing on remedies. So I think we're at 33 now. My husband actually created a blend today for a lot of times people going through chemotherapy really have a hard time with their digestive system. So he really focused on easing some of the symptoms that come with chemotherapy and then able to continue on having normal body functions. Unfortunately, constipation kind of comes with that. And so he really focused on making sure the systems are working thoroughly. We actually have a four-year-old little boy in Fargo that's trying the teas just because his parents doesn't want him on other sorts of things like a Miralax. The tea is a natural way to keep his body functioning even at his young age.
Interesting. Let's talk some about the products and maybe which have proven to be the most popular.
So a lot of people come in and looking for flavor. We have this great green tea called Grandma's Garden. It's strawberry, mango, and pear, and it is an imported tea from Japan called Sencha. And so that one is so popular because you can make it hot, you can make it cold, so it's a nice variety. You can sweeten it and even add milk to it. And for a lot of palates, no matter what things you like and dislike, that fruitiness and that fullness of that flavor tends to appeal to a lot of people. But we always have really good sellers in each type, you know, really good white, really good green. And we've really promoted the puer side of it. That's that fifth type of tea we talked about. So it's white, green, oolong, black, and puer. It's a fermented tea. And nowadays, the kombuchas are really popular. Eating fermented foods is really good for your digestive system. And so the puer is a fermented tea. They actually lay down wet black tea, and then they lay dry on top of it, and they stir it. And they'll do that for several months, and then it'll age for 7 years. So it's a really good wine. So it's this really nice dark tea, but the digestive properties are great. It's got probiotics, it's good for your heart health, and then it's a great metabolism booster. Because that's one of the common questions people have when they come in. You know, do you have weight loss or metabolism type teas? And so that's a great option.
We're going to come back to some of the health benefits.
Sure.
When did you decide to expand and to West Fargo from Bismarck?
Well, we knew being in Bismarck was great. We had super customers. You know, we were very busy, but we thought maybe we wanted to get a little bit further out. We wanted to get our products to more areas. We do a lot of internet orders. We actually ship something out every day. And a lot of that came from the eastern part of the state. And we thought maybe that is a good jump for us to expand, to get more people involved, more people into the stores, experience the customer service, experience the health benefits. And that's why we figured going to Fargo was a great option. Very modern thinking out there, because we're kind of alternative with tea. We're not, the coffee, the potatoes, and all that good stuff. And so having a market out there that's a little bit different was a good option for us, just because we're so different.
And so, when did you open it?
We just opened in September of last year.
Okay.
So it's just been a few months.
So with those early months, how is the business compared to Bismarck?
It's slower. And on, you know, where we're at, it's a little bit newer area. And so when you have a lot of construction going on around you, I think people have a hard time knowing where you're at. And so it's just been a little bit slower. It's better than it was when we first opened in Bismarck, just because people know who we are and they're like, oh my gosh, there's a Steepy in town, we can get there. And so that's been really, really good. We have fantastic neighbors in our area, very like-minded people, very health conscious in our little section of our mall. So that's been really great. And then of course, making those new connections and stuff out in Fargo has been really good. So.
But how do you spend your time between the two then?
Well, the first 6 months, we actually had to rent an apartment. So we were between both locations. My husband and I were split up for several days during the week. Our children are 26, 25, and 24. So they didn't care if we were around or not, but we do have a 17-year-old daughter. And so we just split our time with her at home. And then we took our turns out in Fargo. And we did our marketing, got our people hired and did all that. We actually trained our manager for the store in Fargo 6 months in Bismarck. So that worked out really well because she had a grip on the business, knew what we wanted to do, and then she could pick up some of that slack when we weren't there. So.
Okay. Well, let's turn back to the health benefits. Sure. You've talked a little bit, but so let me just ask you the open-ended question. What are the health benefits of tea?
Okay, so tea really has been scientifically proven that its natural inherent properties of the tea are good, have high antioxidants, and are good at cancer fighting. That's just a normal property of the tea. Depending on the type of tea you choose, those properties go up and down. So the healthiest tea, the tea with the most antioxidants, unfortunately the lightest flavor, is a white tea. So that's going to have the bud of the plant, which contains all of those pieces. Then as you work down the spectrum, you move into green teas, and those have a special catechin in it called EGCG. That's your fat burner. And so that's why green tea tends to be more mainstream and more marketed, because it's a little bit more popular, a little bit less expensive to bring to market than a white tea is. And then, of course, you move down into black teas, which still have the health benefits, not as much as green and white do, but you have a little more flavor. A lot of times people will say tea just is like a funny flavored water. But when you move into the black tea, it has a little bit more base, so a little bit more flavor for you.
Mm-hmm. And you said this is scientifically proven.
Absolutely.
Okay. So it is. Talk about the history of tea, if you can.
Sure. Well, there's a lot of wives' tales on how it was developed, but they felt that in 330 BC, there was a gentleman who was out making his way across the continent of China, and he made his rest under a tree, and he had his hot water boiling because he was going to make his dinner. They say that the tea tree had grown, dropped leaves into his water, he didn't even realize it, and it was boiling and boiling and boiling away, and they started to drink it. Here, there was tea leaves in there. And that's how they say it started. There's different things with tea. Obviously, different countries are where we get our teas from, China, Japan, Sri Lanka, because unfortunately, America doesn't have the right elevation or the right atmosphere to grow tea. And so there's always different stories from each of the countries, too, on how they do their things. So everyone has their own tea ceremony. Each has their own origin type things. And so it's always fun. But that's the big story, is that he developed tea because it dropped into his water while he was resting.
So again, you get, do you order from different countries at all?
Absolutely. So we have an importer, mm-hmm. and he is also an herbologist, just to make sure we don't put things together that can make you really sick. Mm-hmm. But then we do also import our own teas as well. So we work with small farmers in the different countries that are willing to send stuff over, and we buy in bulk. You know, we usually buy between 20 to 50 pounds of tea at a time. So it's really interesting trying to store it. Mm-hmm. And then we do our blends ourselves. So we'll add our rose, we'll add our strawberries, we'll add our mangoes, we'll add our pineapples. And we do all of those fruits separately into the blends, making the different types of tea.
Mm-hmm. Now, you know, you started one business and then you expanded the business. Mm-hmm. How difficult is it to really start a business?
Well, you know, there's a lot of dedication. There's a lot of sleeplessness. There's a lot of 70 to 80 hour work weeks, which we still do, and that's okay. But that's our passion. That's what we wanted to do. We worked for other people as well, but you know what? We were happier doing it like this. And so there's always barriers to entry in a lot of these. That's why we ended up studying for 2 years about teas, working with the Specialty Tea Institute, going through all of our classes to make sure we can properly give information on why tea is so healthy and important for you. But then you still have the background where you have to make the business profitable. You have to have good customer service. You have to find the right employees. We have to work together the best way possible in order to make sure that all of that happens. And so it's always hard. It's never easy. It's never, oh gosh, I own my own business. Look at me. I can do what I want. No, we can pinch a penny like you have no idea. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, but it's fun. We would never want to do anything else.
Mm. Now, I understand you've brought two samples for
me
to try. tell me about this one first, the darker one.
Okay,
here.
So a lot of people do come in our store, and unfortunately, they've either chose themselves to move away from coffee, or the doctor has told them to move away from coffee. And so that is going to be the yerba mate. That is a roasted tea from South America. The reason it has such a nice, full, round, robust taste is the roasting of the tea leaf. So it's very similar to roasting of the coffee bean. And so for people who have to move into tea but may not want to go all the way, this is a nice half a step because it's got a real rich, full taste. And we can jazz it up a little bit. We added a little bit of sweetener at 20 calories and a little bit of chocolate almond milk. And so it really makes it a lot and a dessert, but very little calories.
And here's what I can say about it. I'm not a coffee drinker. If you're a coffee drinker, you might like this. this.
Good. So that's awesome.
Because it does taste a lot like coffee.
Yeah.
And as I told you before we came on, I'm not a coffee drinker at all. So I would not order this, sure. But a coffee drinker would. My
Absolutely.
Wife would probably love it.
And that's why we have it in the fridge every day, because people like it cold. It's a great afternoon treat. The reason mate is very popular is because it raises the iron in your blood. And so for people who are anemic, it's a great health option. So a lot of people who may like to donate blood, or they always kind of run through mm-hmm. that on a monthly cycle for women, it's nice to have that option. And it doesn't have all caffeine. It even has matein. For some people who are very susceptible to how caffeine makes them feel, this is another option for that too.
And of course, that's why I tried that one first.
Right.
So the second one you brought me.
So now this is a cold steeped white tea. Okay. So we put the white tea leaves, it's mm-hmm. passion fruit and a hint of spearmint, all natural organic products, and we cold steeped it overnight, giving this nice fruited flavor the next day.
You're right, and I can taste that.
Yeah. Yeah. And mm-hmm. so white tea is your healthiest. It's got the most antioxidants, the most catechins, and a smidge of caffeine at about 6% of coffees.
Okay.
The reason white tea is a great option in the afternoon is it actually helps you shrink some fat cells, gives you a little boost of energy to make it to that 5 o'clock time frame, but it doesn't mess with your sleep pattern.
We have I'm going to drink all this.
You
then.
Should.
No, I'm sorry. But you mentioned hot and cold a mm-hmm. couple of times today.
Yeah, absolutely.
Why some hot, some cold?
Honestly, there isn't a tea in our store that we haven't made hot or we've made cold. Really, it comes down to how people like their tea. I drink every single one of my teas iced. And a lot of people only drink it hot. So you get a lot of people who do come and go, especially with summertime. They may drink their hot teas, but don't come in the summer. But we've perfected a better iced tea taste. It's not grandma's jar on the porch with 25 Lipton tea bags and about that much sugar in it sitting in sun tea. Because you had to cover that up so much just to get good flavor. We actually kind of perfected that cold steep method, giving you a better, truer taste of the tea and getting all the health benefits without having to cover it up with sugars or sweetener, you know, any of that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. So, and that's why the cold teas are very popular. We usually feature between 12 to 16 in the summertime every day.
Yeah. Well, growing up in the South, as I did, tea was a staple, but brewed tea and good
Lots
brewed
of sweetener.
Tea. Yeah, have you ever tried, you know, certain teas, maybe some of your blends that didn't turn out so popular?
Oh, gosh, yeah. You know, we have over 212 right now. Yeah. We probably have weeded out 50 to 60 different teas. And honestly, it just comes down to flavors. You know, some people may not like the mixture of a lavender, a rose, and an orange. Okay, so we didn't know that. So some people did, some people didn't. We pull them away. But there's been a lot of our teas that we've culled out in the first 3 or so years and we've brought back. And now because we're better at our jobs, we're better at talking about the teas, we're better at making the teas, they're actually really popular now. You know, so that's kind of fun.
But 212, how do you come in and look at the board or look at something and go,
I know.
Which one do I want?
Right, and that's why we work with every customer one-on-one and we ask those questions. So what sounds good today? Do you want something hot or cold? Mm-hmm. The benefit of tea is it can taste like however you want it to taste. If you want it to taste like strawberries, great, here's my selection. If you want it to taste like coffee, I can do that for you too. And so it really comes down to you deciding and telling me exactly what you like, and we can narrow that menu down to you super easily. So,
yeah. What kind of feedback do you get from your customers, and do you get a lot of return customers?
Oh gosh, yeah. We do get 5 or 6 new people every day who have said, "Oh, I heard about you from so and so," or "I haven't been here yet." So that's always great. But yeah, we have a lot of repeat people that either come get their teas at lunch. We have this huge group of morning gentlemen that come in. They're very well retired, and they come in and tell me everything about politics for about an hour every morning. And they honestly do tea too. They're not coffee drinkers. They're totally tea drinkers. So yes, we have a great combination of a lot of return people, and then of course we have our new ones, which is fun.
Well, very quick, what do you think the future holds for you and your stores?
Gosh, I hope lots and lots of great things. You know, we're trying to promote wellness as best as we can, and why not try something that's natural and comes from the earth as opposed to going a different route? It's a great thing to try. So,
Well, with that said too, if people want more information, where can they go? Who can they contact?
Oh, gosh, you can come in either one of our stores. Jerry and I are usually in the Bismarck store. Becca is our manager in Fargo. And then, of course, use the internet, email us, call us, whatever you want to do.
Well, we wish you the best of luck.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us
today. Appreciate
it.
Thanks.
Stay tuned for more. In the 1970s, when the last child of early settlers, Adam and Wilhelmina Stein, left the family home in Georgetown, Minnesota, a treasure trove by reclusive local artist Annie Stein was finally brought to light. Here's a look.
Annie Stein's significance as an artist is for people around here to know shortly after the sodbusters came in with their plows, the art scene began. Annie Stein was born in Georgetown in 1872, right when a couple miles south of her house, there were two lawless Wild West tent towns built on either side of a railroad bridge that would later become Moorhead and Fargo.
Well, Annie grew up really on the raw edge of the frontier, and her parents were very, very early settlers around here. And that influenced the artwork that she did, the subjects that she painted. Because they were such early settlers around here, she had a real strong sense of her family's place in local history and their importance in that, their significance in it. So she remained on the farm pretty much her whole life. I don't think she traveled a lot, and she was a completely self-taught artist. So she painted the things that she knew. She painted the things around her, her family, her community, her surroundings, and in some cases, neighbors. She was a real homebody.
She died young at age 51 in 1923. So people forgot about that Stein girl that was a painter. Then in 1976, the Stein family has a huge auction of everything in that house. And out of nowhere, all of a sudden, there's all these paintings of Georgetown. And people are just shocked.
She was very, very prolific. Subject matter varied. Primarily, it's her family, of course, activities going on in the farm, their farmhouse. But lots of other things as well. She took photographs.
To a local historians like us, it's some of the best illustrations that we have of things like the Great Flood of 1897. How high did it get? Well, you can see that the Stein house is surrounded. Her paintings, they show what life was like back then. She was really just a really fascinating person, a Renaissance woman. She seemed to have dabbled in most of the creative and intellectual pursuits that were available to women of her generation. She was a painter, a poet, a fiber artist, and a gardener, a photographer.
She came from a family of photographers. Several of her siblings dabbled in photography. She was probably the most creative of the bunch. Photography in those days, before 1890 or so, virtually all the photographers working were professionals. Most people were using glass plates to capture their images, and there weren't a whole lot of amateurs that were involved in that. Annie was one of them, however. It was a challenging process, and it was difficult and fairly expensive. It was an expensive hobby for somebody living on a farm in rural Minnesota, I'm sure. But she seemed to very, very much enjoy it and reveled in it.
In some of Annie Stein's photography, we see people, they're posing for the photo, sitting in the Stein living room that probably not family. And on the back of these pictures, we see this kind of stamp or logo or something that says Annie Stein photographer. So she seems to be at some level of professionalism. She was proud of her work. I see somebody who is trying to kind of poke at the glass ceiling. She does a lot of self-portraits for photography, and studying those pictures, we think, oh, she's not really, it's not so much a self-portrait, it's she's showing off her artwork, the lace that she made, or the pillows next to her that she made, as well as taking portraits of herself in front of her paintings. So on the back of many of these paintings, and many of Annie's paintings, it says, please do not criticize this work too much, for God alone was my master. And we just loved that phrase because it tells us a lot about Annie, actually. It tells us that she is self-taught. Now, God alone was my master. What she means by that is that she didn't follow the traditional master-apprentice way that artists back then were taught. She didn't go to college. So it's humility, but I think also hidden in there is a kind of as much as Minnesotans can get to bragging, you know, because it is humble in one way, but she's also saying that God alone is my master. And there's a little bit of pride in there, I think, maybe too.
Well, that's all we have on Prairie Pulse for this week. But as always, thanks for watching.
Funding for Minnesota Legacy programs are provided by a grant from the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund, with money from the vote of the people of Minnesota on November 4th, 2008. And by the members of Prairie Public.